Hello everyone! In this edition of The Expert's Voice, we will be hearing from Dr. Ian Hamerton, a leading researcher in polymer and composite materials.
Hey, my name is Ian Hamerton. I'm the reader in polymers and composite materials in Axis in the University of Bristol. So my interest in composite materials stems to childhood and particularly an interest in aviation. Going through with my father many years ago looking at air displays and interest in aircraft, early aircraft, and also making model kits. As I became a chemist, working on very, very small sort of scale, working with atoms and molecules. Really I wanted to get into a more tangible way, looking at how materials could be used, and that meant scaling up to polymers and from polymers into composites and reinforced materials. My research interests span a range of areas, from designing materials for use and application in pretty demanding environments. So typically making materials which would be able to withstand high temperatures or radiation or large mechanical loads. And that means ideally designing materials for use. And so having an interest in everything from designing the material from scratch, from using molecular simulation, molecular modeling, through to making materials, making new building blocks, new monomers, producing polymers, introducing them into composite materials, and also looking at recycling and sustainable development. Both matrix and fiber and additives need to be derived from more sustainable feedstocks. From the most simple cases, maybe looking at potential replacements for reinforcements from fibers derived from natural sources. That's got a long way to go at the moment. I think even the most optimistic observer would say that natural fibers certainly enable us to produce low-grade composites. We're not at the stage where those materials naturally produce high-performance polymer composites. However, the potential to use bio-based feedstocks, which can be made into carbon fibers, is certainly another route, using pitch or sugar-based materials in order to make carbon fibers from other sources, potentially sources which are more sustainable, so that we're not simply using up these resources, but we're potentially using them for other uses. The other area that kind of needs to go hand in hand with that is producing polymer matrices, the resin, from materials which are then inherently more recyclable, ultimately. So sustainable from the source where they may be bio-derived, but also may be degraded, recycled into other building blocks, or reused again for other applications. The question of whether thermoplastics will replace thermosets has been something that's been sort of circulating for a while. Thermoplastics inherently tend to be more tough. They have the potential to be recycled, and so that makes them certainly more attractive than conventional thermosets, where recycling at the end of life is very, very difficult. Really, at this stage, practically very, very hard to recycle the materials other than into a comparatively low value application. Will thermoplastics ever totally replace thermosets? I think at the current stage of application, current sort of rate of growth, it's unlikely you'll get complete supplanting of thermosets with thermoplastics. I think they'll continue to be a niche, quite a substantial niche, where thermosets are going to be still, very much in use. As things stand at the moment, thermoplastics require substantial advances in processing to make them applicable to a wide range of composites. In the future, looking much, much further ahead, I can see a bigger future for thermoplastics. But at the moment, the kind of key research that needs to be done is introducing a method of getting better compatibility between fibers and matrix at the present time. The whole concept of multifunctional composites is something which is really very much on the radar at the moment. A lot of people are talking about multifunctionality, and this means a lot of things to different people. Principally, it's a means of moving beyond a simple structural material, so the composite is not simply affording the kind of mechanical and structural properties to the component. But it begins to hint at materials which have the ability perhaps to conduct electricity, to conduct more heat, so increasing thermal and electrical conductivity, but also to change optical properties as well. There's a lot of scope to expand this sort of this whole sort of field. But at this stage, the whole idea of putting into a composite, into the matrix, perhaps nanoparticles, these might be inorganic nanoparticles, nanosilicates, or graphene oxide materials, so that one can begin to change the inherent electrical or thermal conductivity of the material. Going forward into composites, the real potential is to not only modify the matrix, but also begin to modify the fibers. And work we've done recently looking at introducing carbon nanotubes onto the surface of the fiber. These are called hairy fibers or fuzzy fibers. And this enables us to do two things, many things, but two particularly. We can introduce greater electrical conductivity into the composite as a result. In the case of an aircraft, this may be that lightning strike is a big issue. Increasing the conductivity of the composite means that we can begin to maybe dissipate that charge particularly. But also it means that we can introduce a better interface between the matrix and the composite and the fiber. So the composite is really made far more integral. We're able to introduce not so much an interface, a sharp region between the fiber and the matrix, but what we would call an interphase region. So there's a far better intimate mixture between fiber and matrix. This means loads and stresses can be carried far more efficiently from the matrix to the fiber. You get to a stage in your life, I guess, when you start looking back and try to examine your own impact of your own work on society in general. As an educator and researcher, it's sometimes easier to put that in the context of the people that you've trained. There are always material advances to which you can point. There are always publications or books that you can show as being kind of your tangible, the tangible benefits that you've left behind. And certainly it's possible to look at particular books that you're proud of. I think that probably a more tangible way of examining this is to look at the people that you've trained. And I'm getting to a vintage now where I can begin to see people who are coming through who have started out with their PhDs with me back in the mid-90s and are now getting to the stages where they are kind of arriving at places in their careers where they're now heading up their own research groups, where they're taking on their roles in industry. I recently met up with one of my very early, almost one of my first PhD students who's now heading up a kind of a research effort in a major thermoplastic company with sort of international links now. And that's something which is really quite, certainly something which gives one a tangible sort of feeling of pride that, the education's been kind of passed on, the torch has been passed on to carry, so that people are now beginning to look at materials development again, and these are the next generation of researchers who are going on to take that sort of work forward.
Thank you for watching. We hope you enjoyed this edition of The Expert's Voice. See you next time.